Hi guys, and welcome to another episode of Positively Negative. Today we'll be taking a look at a very famous cult classic Soviet-made lens, the Helios 44M-6. Now, why is this lens so famous and beloved by photographers and videographers alike? Well, it's because of its famous image characteristics. This lens, wide open at f2, creates an extremely dreamlike, wistful, swirly, bokehlicious image, okay? And that's the exact reason why I wanted to get it, because I love that sort of dreamlike imagery. And I think it's wonderful for both analog photography and for digital filmmaking as well. But before we look at sample images and before we talk a little bit more about that sort of stuff, I just want to get into a little bit of the history of this lens, because it's actually quite fascinating. So when the Soviet Union defeated Germany in the Second World War, they decided that Germany's glass manufacturing companies like Carl Zeiss might be better suited serving Soviet needs. So they took the Carl Zeiss Jena lens designs and basically Russianified them and made knockoffs of Carl Zeiss Jena designs. So this Helios 44M is actually a Soviet copy of the Carl Zeiss Jena Biotar 58mm f2 lens, right? But isn't that interesting? It's sort of like the Russians took it as reparations or something, or the spoils of victory. Thereafter, they produced the lens for about 50 years until the mid-90s, and some people say that it might be the most common lens in the world, because basically they made millions upon millions upon millions of these lenses, and they served as the standard, or shall we call it even the kit lens, for many Zenit SLR cameras, of which I have one right here. Now, this is a special edition of the Zenit 122 SLR camera. It was made to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the factory that made these cameras. So it actually came out in the early 90s, just after the fall of the Soviet Union. Isn't that cool? And this camera would have come standard stock with a Helios 44M lens, right? This would have been the kit lens for the camera. So this particular one is an M42 mount, so it's a screw mount lens. You also get them in Pentax K mount, right? Now the M mounted ones, the M42 mounts are called 44M, and the K mounts are called 44K. So if you see one for sale, know that 44K is for a Pentax K mount and 44M is for an M42 screw mount lens mount. The number that comes after the M, so for example mine is a 44M6, refers to the sharpness of the lens. So supposedly the 44M1 is the least sharp, going all the way up to a 44M7, which is supposedly the sharpest of them all. Mine is one of the more recent ones. It's obviously from the 90s, because the camera is from the 90s, and it's also a multi-coated version. All right, so this is about as modern as these lenses get. Although they have no modern features or accoutrement, there's no autofocus, there's no auto exposure. All you have is a manual aperture ring going from f2 to f16, and a very nice and smooth focus ring that takes forever to focus from infinity to its closest distance. Right, so if you're going to mount this on a digital camera, bear in mind that you're going to have to use it in manual mode, because it's got nothing fancy, no automatic exposure settings whatsoever. As you can see, it's a very compact lens. It's like a nifty 50, even though it's a 58mm. And it's built very well. It's nice and solid. Even though it's got lots of plastic bits on the outside, especially the aperture ring is a little bit plasticky, it does feel very solid in the hand. It feels very well made. Maybe not as well made as a Pentax Super Takuma lens, but then again, what is as well made as a Pentax Super Takuma lens? But it feels very good. You're not doubting that this is a quality bit of kit. The best part about these lenses is that they are extremely cheap. To put it in perspective, I paid 500 Rand for this lens and this special edition Zenit 122 camera. Now the seller, I just wanted the lens, but the seller was a collector up in Johannesburg, and he refused to part them. He said that the camera and the lens belong together and you must take both. And he gave them to me both for 500 Rand, which is about $30. Of course, being a M42 mount lens, I can mount this lens onto my Pentax SV, or with the right adapter, I can mount it onto my digital Canon camera or my digital Sony camera. So for example, I have here a EF2 M42 mount. So it's just like a little metal ring that you then screw the lens onto this ring, like so. like so, and then that mounts onto your digital Canon DSLR, and it works perfectly. Bearing in mind, if you have a crop sensor camera, the lens becomes effectively like a 90 millimeter lens, which is great for portrait lenses, but you do lose a little bit of that swirliness, because that swirliness tends to happen on the edges of the frame, and obviously a crop sensored camera crops in a little bit, so you lose the edges. The Sony adapter I have looks like this. So this is for something like a Sony A7 or an A9, or you know, any sort of full frame Sony camera. And it works just like the other adapter. You just screw your lens in here, and then this adapter then mounts to the camera body itself. So you see it's a sort of extension thing, because obviously a mirrorless camera, you need to build in that extra distance that used to be occupied by a mirror. Now both of these adapters do a nice thing in that they compress or depress the aperture pin at the back of these M42 lenses. So what these pins do is they keep the lens wide open at f2 so that you can compose your image. But if you stop down to say f11 or f16, which I will do now, f16, there's a little pin on the back of the lens that when depressed stops down the lens. Now that normally happens at the moment that you press the trigger. The lens stops down, so you take the photograph at f16. But if you're shooting video, for example, with a DSLR or a Sony A7, this pin needs to be depressed all the time so that you can change apertures. Otherwise, the lens will stay open at f2. So you need to get yourself an adapter that is built to depress that pin so that when you change the aperture, it does change on the lens. So now let's move on to image quality and the image characteristics, because let's be honest, that's the reason we're all interested in these lenses, isn't it? These lenses are famous for creating a swirly, dreamlike, nostalgic, wistful image wide open at f2. So I've shot some footage on a Sony a7 III wide open of just plants and things in the back garden, so that you can see this swirliness in effect. And afterwards, we'll look at some photographs I've taken on 35mm film as well. Now, what I really love about this lens as well is not only the swirliness, not only the dreamlike bokeh, all of that stuff. I mean, obviously that's great, but what I really like is that you can use it as a day-to-day lens in other ways as well. Because once you stop down to like f4 or f5.6, the lens loses that ridiculous dreamlike characteristics and just becomes a really sharp, good, standard prime lens, right? So it's almost like a Jekyll and Hyde lens. It's almost got like two personalities in one. Wide open, it's got that really almost like effect lens characteristic. And then stop down, it's just a really sharp, good 58mm standard prime lens. So you can keep it on your camera and you can use it for all sorts of things, which I do. I mean, I use it for landscapes, I use it for like, you know, cityscapes, street photography, that sort of thing, as well as for portraits and for close-ups. The other great thing is it's very close focusing. It focuses to 0.5 meter, which is like 1.5 feet, something like that for the Americans. And obviously 58 being almost like a short telephoto, 0.5 meter away is very close. So you're getting like almost a macro lens, which is just great. So it's an extremely versatile lens. That is not just a one-trick pony regarding its f2 aperture. It actually can do all sorts of things, right? And for 500 Rand plus a camera body, I think that's probably the best deal in photography. Now, obviously, my first love is for analog photography. So now let's take a look at some photographs that I've taken on 35mm film in both color and black and white. And you'll see the swirliness, and you'll also see the sharpness where the lens is stopped down. Alright guys, so from me and the Helios lens, that's it for this episode. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.